You're going to fly this airplane a lot more than you think right now. When you get in the air, you're going to get to do a lot of the flying, most of the flying, 95% of it, you're doing it. It's the first time you've flown a Mustang, so I'm there to coach you. I do a lot of talking, I do a lot of coaching. It's what you would call heavy on the controls, mm-hmm. but it's responsive. Mm-hmm. Right? It weighs 8,000 pounds, and you're used to 1,000 pounds. So, and it's moving very fast. Mm-hmm. So you don't move the controls very much, and it's responsive. The key to this is to use the trims mm-hmm. a lot. Because mm-hmm. if you get out of trim, if you push the nose down, it's heavy. Mm-hmm. If you pull the nose up, it will wear your arm out. Mm-hmm. And you're a big guy. You're in shape, you know. You'll get out of the airplane and go, why does my arm hurt so much? That's because you weren't trimming. Mm-hmm. We trim these all the time. I'll be reminding you to trim it. Mm-hmm. If you use the trims, use the rudder and the elevator trim.
I never used the rudder trim before.
Exactly. You never had one before. Exactly. Yeah. So I'll be reminding you and helping you out with that. Mm-hmm. Okay? But like I said, I want you to do as much of this as possible. I want you to experience as much of this Mustang flying as possible. So just stay on the controls. Keep doing what you're doing. If something really bad happens, I'll take it. We're going to take off as a two-ship. We're going to take off with a five-second delay, but we get to do some formation work. Mm-hmm. They're using runway 15. Now, we're right here, Pete. We're underneath Orlando's airspace. Yes. So we've got a 2,000-foot ceiling next to a 4,000-foot, mm-hmm. next to a 6,000-foot.
Okay.
So what we're going to do is take off, go that way.
Yes.
What we do is go right across the 4,000-foot zone into the 6,000-foot mm-hmm. zone, and then turn left and go south. Mm-hmm. That way we can stay underneath and not talk to them.
Yeah, okay.
So once we're past Horsehead, we're out from under Orlando. We'll climb up to 8,500 feet or so.
Okay.
All right. Now, at that point, we're still going to be in formation. This nice. From here to here, that's when you get to do some formation flying. Mm. Now, I'm going to assume you've never done that. Have you done any formation?
Actually, yes.
Yeah? We are going to actually, he'll call the range, which mm-hmm. is a restricted area. It's a bombing range at Avon Park. And see if we can get in there. Mm-hmm. And if so, you and I will stay north of this map right here, yeah. over that lake, and he'll go south of it. Mm-hmm. And that's when we get away from each other. Mm-hmm. All right. After takeoff, we're gonna come in here, we call that route. And that means no overlap, right? Yeah. And then he'll clear me. We're number two on the way out.
Okay.
We're number one on the way back.
All right.
Okay. And then we'll do what's called a cross-under. You know what a cross-under is. We go under his wake and get on the other side. Give you the airplane and let you work it. Now, a Mustang's not easy to do formation in because even though they're exactly the same airplane, it doesn't slow down good. Mm-hmm. And it speeds up real good. So if you're behind the guy and you add too much power, it's hard to slow it back down. So I'll be coaching you a lot there. And we'll get a few minutes of formation then. And then we'll get away from each other. And then we get to do whatever really you want to do. Safety's the priority here. Safety's number one.
Safety first.
We're always looking for other airplanes.
Better safe than sorry.
That's right. So once we start turning, we could see real good because of that bubble canopy. It's hard for another airplane to get close to us without us seeing it.
That's so. What it was designed for.
Exactly.
World War II.
Exactly. That's what that bubble canopy is all about. It's great. You're going to love it. It's better than a biplane by a long shot. You know, you don't have that wing up there. Okay. It also pulls a couple of G's, all right? So we'll feel some G's and see how we feel. It's called what we call a G warm-up, mm-hmm. all right? So that's the warm-up. So I'll have you pull a couple of G's there. But it's not easy to keep it level. Just try to... You can't use, you know what a vertical speed indicator is?
Yep.
Okay, the rate of climb?
Sure.
Because it's lying to you. You can't use it. Use the altimeter instead.
Okay.
All right, try to keep it at 8,500 feet or whatever we're at, like that. But don't stare at the instrument. Look outside.
Exactly, that's what my feeling would be to check on the horizon.
Exactly.
The nose.
You've got to find that picture, what it looks like. Okay. Mm. Then we're going to do slow flight. We'll pull the power back to 26 inches. pull the nose up, let it climb, and we'll go to about 90 knots on the airspeed. But what I really want you to do, 90 knots is just the baseline speed. It's just to get you where I want you to start. At about 88 knots, you'll feel a little bit of a stall buffet. You know what a buffet is? A little bit of a shake. It's very subtle. But at about 84 knots, it's a shake. And it's still got 3 knots to go before it actually stalls. It's a really cool buffet margin. So we'll do that. Once we're kind of right on the edge, I'll have you maneuver left and right, like this, just to see how stable it is. And then we'll stall the airplane.
Using the rudder?
You can use the rudder. Yeah. It's a good demonstration to use the rudder of the yaw roll couple. All right. But I want you to do both. I want you to do the ailerons and then the rudder.
Yeah. Okay. I'd love to.
Play with that. The difference is the airfoil is almost symmetrical, like an aerobatic airplane. Very symmetrical. But it's also laminar. It's very fat way back here. So it stalls a little different than most wings that we're used to flying. So when it does stall, it'll let go. It's kind of benign. It'll just let go. And you got to get the nose below the horizon to let it accelerate. And the thing that's not intuitive is you've got to use the aileron to bring the wing back up. Because the rudder will just yaw the airplane.
Sure.
It won't work. But in most airplanes, we're taught to use the rudder to bring the wing up, right? In your airplane, it probably works just fine. Well, it won't do it in a Mustang. The worst thing is, Pete, it's bad for the airplane. That it's got a long moment arm there, and the prop weighs 450 pounds, and it's out there doing this. It'll actually get the spinner into the cowling. It'll start damaging the airplane. That's the big reason we don't do it. And the engine doesn't like it either. Because the crankshaft is that long with a 450-pound prop on it, and it's doing that, too. It doesn't like it too much. So after we've done our stalls, we may do an accelerated stall. I may have you put the wing down and pull and do a stall and recover from that, just to get a feel for it. Then we're going to go right back up to 37 inches. All you have to do is just enjoy flying the airplane. All right, wing overs. 37 inches, 2,300 RPM. 210 knot dive, pull the nose up. This is the part you're really going to enjoy. It's got a lot of energy. It keeps going up. It's like a jet. You know, most small planes, you got to do something right away. This airplane, just be patient. It goes up and up and up. Put a wing down, keep it positive, and do about 180 degree wing over. Now, when we go left, there's so much torque involved with this that you don't need left rudder. To do this, keep the ball in the middle. It's going this way.
Right. Okay.
And
yeah, that, yeah.
And the torque is trying to take it that way. So much so that you might actually have a right rudder to keep the ball in the middle. A little bit of right rudder. When you go right, you gotta have a pretty good bit of right rudder. So check the ball. Make sure the ball's in the middle. Okay. That's why we do these, so you can get used to that. Aileron roll. 210 knots. Pull the nose up about there. Stop the pull. And then put all the aileron in. Now this is where you use all of it.
How many degrees up?
20.
20 only.
20 degrees above the rise. It's not very far in this airplane. Not like a light plane. Not in this. This is more like a jet. Just pull up about 20 degrees above the horizon, but you got to stop the pull. It's not a positive maneuver, right? You can do it at zero G and use all the aileron. Don't worry about the rudder. This isn't a biplane. It's like I said, more like a jet. And it'll do a really nice aileron roll. Okay, we'll go left and right. All right, a barrel roll is, I go to 230 knots, pull the nose way up like a wing over, 60 degrees or more. This is a positive maneuver. Keep it a little bit positive as you start a roll. And the way we teach it, Pete, is you start out on that heading. When you're inverted, you're 90 degrees that way. And when you finish up, you're on that heading again. Okay? It's a good way to learn barrel rolls, as a matter of fact. As an instructor, it's easier for me to teach that way. So we'll look for references on the ground and 90 degrees out. Barrel rolls are a lot of fun. We might do a few of those. A loop, 260 knots. Going down, that's 300 miles an hour. Easy pull. You don't want to induce a lot of drag. It's not like a small plane. Easy pull to get the nose coming up. And then you put that 2.5 G's on right about here. Now, in a light plane, when you do a loop, you tend to get on top and unload it. right, to make it round. Mm-hmm. You reduce the back pressure a lot. People in a Mustang do that too much. You've got to keep a little bit of positive pressure just to draw that arc over the top. If you unload it too much, it just squares off the top like that.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, you'll see what I mean when you do it. The big difference is right here. Mm-hmm. We got an 8,000-pound airplane with a laminar flow wing. You don't have much G available here, and you have to wait longer than you think to let it accelerate. It has to be like here before you can start squeezing those G's in. And you've got to be careful then, because it'll go to the buffet and it'll drop a wing, and you'll see exactly what I mean if you pull too hard. Okay. So I say things like, okay, pull the nose up, easy. All right, pull harder, pull harder, pull harder, easy, easy. Now, squeeze the G's back in like that, and we'll see how you do.
Okay.
Okay. Now, there's a lot of stuff we can do here. Cuban 8, mm-hmm. like a loop. Mm-hmm. 45 degree down line, stop the pull, half roll. Boom. If you do two of those, you've drawn an eight in the sky. Mm-hmm. A lot of fun. Mm-hmm. What the British call a roll off the top, we call it an Immelmann. It's the same maneuver. 260 knots, mm-hmm. up over the top. When the nose is just above the horizon there, stop the pull, half roll, and it's still going to try to barrel the nose down on you, Pete, like that. Mm-hmm. So halfway through the half roll, add some back pressure to hold the nose up.
Needs some practice.
Needs a little bit. Okay? Very good. Now, you're used to using a lot more rudder than you're going to need in this airplane. This airplane doesn't need much rudder at all. Mm-hmm. So you're going to have a tendency to push rudder in, and the ball's going to swing way out the other way until you get used to it. Mm-hmm. On the way out, or once we get away from the other airplane, I'll have you do what we call quick aileron reversals, where we go left, right, and try to keep the ball in the middle with the rudders. Right. And you'll see that you just need a little bit of pressure. The rudders are heavy, but you don't move them much. Sure. They're not light like we're used to. They're very heavy, but they only move like that much. So, okay. Reverse cubit, split S. 45 degree upline, half roll at 150 knots, and pull. That's a split S. Right? You can really pull some G's here, and you can really lose some altitude there. So I usually save that for last when I want to lose some altitude.
Oh, okay.
Okay. I got a whole bag full of stuff for you. Four-point rolls, hesitation rolls, mm-hmm. clover leaf. It's a pull and a quarter roll, and you pull through. And then you do it again and do a quarter roll. Very disorienting.
That's what I think. It's like
you can't figure out where you're going next. Yeah. And you've got to have a good reference. You've got to have a road going that way and a road going that way so you can tell where you are. But it's a great fun maneuver. We might play with that a little bit.
It's like a wing over coordinated, but you get vertical, that wing goes right down. It doesn't go down there, it goes past that. It's almost a roll here. Mm-hmm. But then you bring the bank out, opposite aileron, and now you're going down on a vertical down line. Mm-hmm. You'll have a lot of fun with that in your airplane. But your airplane's going to run out of energy really quick on the way up. So you've got to time it right.
Immediately you're sitting here, and then you have to...
You've got
to
do it early. You got to do it as you're doing it. Make it a big, smooth pulling thing, and just keep it positive.
Okay. All right. When we get done playing around, I'll be looking at my clock, and I'll go, okay, Pete, we got to go back and meet those guys.
Yeah.
We're going to go back to Lake Pierce and meet them.
Okay.
And we're going to be number one. Mm-hmm. So we'll go over there at 6,000 feet, and I'll have you do orbits.
Okay.
And they'll come find you, and they'll be out here somewhere. This is a lot like air combat, cool. World War II air combat, very much so. They got to find us. They'll be either below us or above us, probably above us. And then I'll clear them to rejoin us. You'll hear me say that. En route, they'll rejoin, and then I'll clear them in close, and then I'll clear them to maneuver, and they'll do the same thing we did. We're going to lead them back in from here, back to 1-5, and do an overhead approach. We start out at 1,500 feet, and the tower will let us down to 1,000 when they can. They're trying to fit us into the pattern. So we get down to 1,000. If this is the runway, oh, here's a good runway. If that's the runway, we'll go down to 1,000. We'll come right down the runway, and we'll break either right or left, usually right on 1.5. The tower will tell us. We'll break right, and they'll break 5 seconds later. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like that. So we're in front. Okay, here's the way the brake works. You're still flying. Okay, brake right. I will give you 20 degrees of flaps as you brake. With the flaps, the nose wants to go down, and we got to pull some G. So we'll get it around on the downwind leg, level the wings. But we were doing 200 knots here, and it's hard to get down to 150 knots here to put the gear down. So we might have to wait a moment and actually bring the nose up to slow it down a little bit. And then I'll say, there's 150 knots, gear's coming down. Back me up on the gear because you have three green lights in the back seat. Boom, gear goes down, three green lights. But it also, the more flap you put in, the more it pushes the nose down. So it's almost automatic. You trim the whole time. Okay, so what this will look like, if this is the runway, you're out here, gear's down, I'll say, okay, 30 degrees of flaps, I'll do the flaps, turn right, 130 knots, all right? Keep turning, 120 knots, I'll give you 40 degrees of flaps. What we're looking for, Pete, is 110 knots and full flap. And the airplane looks like this. As it comes down final, you're gonna want to pull the nose up too soon. And I'm gonna keep saying, you keep flying, I'm gonna say, keep the nose down. Keep the nose down. You know, you got your hand on the throttle. You're controlling the speed with pitch. We'll go from 110 to about 100. And then we'll stop looking at the airspeed and I'll say, okay, pull the nose up, pull the nose up, pull the nose up, hold it right there, and then ease the power off and it'll sit down on the main wheels. It's a 2-point landing, okay? Now, when the nose comes up here, you're a tail dragger guy. You know what's gonna happen. You're gonna lose sight of the runway. This nose is very long and skinny, so you can see the edges of the runway pretty well. You'll do just fine. Don't stop flying, just keep flying, and if I have to help you, I'll say, I'm gonna move you over a little bit, or something like that, all right? But this is a lot easier than it sounds in a Mustang, and it's very stable with the gear and the flaps out. And if you do everything smoothly, in a light plane, you might chase the pitch a little bit. I don't want you to do that. Just very smoothly change the pitch to get it to the landing attitude. Because in this airplane, I want you to think about something. You know about gyroscopic precession, the gyroscope. You've got a 450-pound gyroscope on the nose of this thing. When we raise the tail on takeoff, it wants to go left because of the gyroscope, in addition to all the other torque effects. So when you put the tail down, even at idle, it wants to go right. It's not bad, but you'll notice it. So you gotta keep it straight. As you get it on the ground, if you're still going straight, I'll just say, okay, Pete, ease the tail down. Fly the tail to the ground, keep it straight. If it starts moving this way or that way, I'm gonna help you out. I'm gonna say, okay, I've got it, and I'm gonna help you out. But if you're doing just fine, and if you're smooth, everything works out real good. And we'll just let it roll. We're not going to stand on the brakes because the thing weighs 8,000 pounds. It'll burn the brakes right up. Mm-hmm. All right. Very good.
We did good.
Did you see that landing?
Yeah, perfect.
That was a beautiful landing.
Yeah.
That was him.
His touchdown, completely alone, yeah? I saw the touchdown and I think, wow, that was really cool.